Yeah, because now we have to be, because it's final years now, they are literally hard pressed now. The
Yeah,
final
I can
years
understand.
students, actually.
Right. Yeah, that's good. You can share the link individually with everybody, and whoever is
Yes,
interested
because
can.
not everyone is interested, so it is
Yeah,
just a futile
true, yeah.
exercise.
That's right, absolutely true.
So some 8 or 10 of the PGs, they have sent me individual messages and I have sent the link for today.
Oh, good. That's so nice. So we'll start. Good evening, everybody. Welcome to this evening episode of Pursue. Today we have Pursue 4C, which is gynae pathology, and we are streaming live from Kolkata. And today we have with us Colonel Tanushree. She's an MD from AFMC Pune, and a DNB, and an MNA MS, and a professor in the Department of Pathology, Command Hospital, Kolkata. She's trained in oncopathology and affiliate member of Royal College of Pathologists, London. Today's topic will be body of uterus, neoplastic and non-neoplastic lesions. Before I ask her to start, please requesting everybody to keep your mic muted, your camera off, and please don't share your screen. With this, let me request, ma'am, please share your screen and start the lecture, please. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Can you see the screen?
Yes, I can see your screen. Please make it full screen. Yeah, fine. That's
Good
good. Please
evening.
start.
So I will be taking the uterus lesions, the non-neoplastic and neoplastic. And believe me, it's quite extensive. And the non-neoplastics are outnumbering the neoplastic and the tumors, but we will concentrate on both. The benign diseases, I'll start with all these topics, not in very detail, but we'll touch upon each topic and the cycles and the phases, because that is very important. It is the bread and butter of every pathologist. And the metaplasias, polyps, how do you differentiate? What are the IHCs? So all are included in the benign lesion. Uterus, as you know, is a pear-shaped target which serves as physiological site of implantation for fertilized eggs and undergoes changes to support subsequent placental attachment and embryonic and fetal development. The mucosal component is hormonally responsive and undergoes changes throughout the menstrual cycle. The anatomic divisions are the corpus, the uterine cervix, the fundus, which is the dome superior portion, the cornua, lateral portions of the uterine corpus, sites of fallopian tube insertion, isthmus, which is the lower uterine segment. The endometrium and the myometrium development are of mesodermal origin and are formed secondary to fusion of the Mullerian or paramesonephric duct between the 8th and 9th post-ovulatory weeks. During the prepubertal years, the endometrium remains inactive and cervix continues to comprise the major part of the uterus. In the reproductive years, the dimensions and the weight varies widely according to parity. So in nullipara and multigravid uterus, the size differs. The uterus is located between the rectum posteriorly and the urinary bladder. The endometrium during the reproductive period undergoes cyclical morphological changes, which is evident in the functionalist layer, as we will see subsequently. The morphologic alterations are minimal in the deeper one-third. Vascular supply. The arteries penetrate the endometrium at regular intervals, which are the radial arteries, and give rise to the basal arteries. which in turn divide into horizontal and vertical branches. It's the former supplying the blood supply to the endometrial basalis and the later to the overlying functionalis layer. A differentiating feature between the endometrium and myometrial arteries is the absence of subendothelial elastic tissue in the endometrial artery, except for those in the basal layer and its presence in the myometrial artery. This is the histology. As you see here, the myometrium and the endometrium with stratum basalis and stratum functionalis. Stratum basalis is a deep layer of the endometrium, which is minimally hormone responsive and serves to replenish the stratum functionalis following menses. Stratum functionalis, hormone responsive superficial layer of the endometrium. Myometrium is the structural wall of uterus composed primarily of smooth muscles. Then the serosa is the thin outermost layer. So this all functional anatomy is very important during the staging and the phases and also in the growthing. When you get a specimen of a hysterectomy for a carcinoma of endometrium, so this all, the depth of invasion, the myometrial involvement, very important. The positive IHC stain for endometrial glands, PAX8, CK7, ERPR, endometrial stroma, CD10, ERPR, IFITM1, myometrium, SMA, desmin, H-calcium. In infants and children, the endometrium is functionally inactive. Menarche, first occurrence of the menstruation, and then there are various phases. The menstrual phase is day 0 to 5, proliferative phase day 6 to 14, and secretory phase days 15 to 28. I will show the photomicrograph of the different phases subsequently. Then there can be congenital defects and the Mullerian duct abnormalities, which can be due to the hormonal excess in utero or imbalances in the hormones. The abnormalities of fusion can occur, or there can be atresia of the Mullerian duct and vagina. There's a syndrome called as Rokitansky-Kuster-Hauser syndrome, a severe defect characterized by Mullerian and vaginal eclasia. Patients may have urinary tract anomalies, the pelvic kidney or endometrium. This is the proliferative phase endometrium. Cellular blue appearance, round to tubular glands, even regular spacing between the glands, pseudo-stratified columnar cells, numerous mitotic figures. Interval phase between the proliferative and secretory, when they partially develop subnuclear vacuoles. With less than 50% of cells in a gland with continuous and well-developed subnuclear vacuoles. In the secretory phase, in microscope, what you see is relatively pink appearance at low power, convoluted, irregularly shaped glands, single layer of columnar or cuboidal cells. It could be divided into the early, mid, and the late secretory phases. And the timing you have to do based upon the features what you see under the microscope. It's the early secretory phase endometrium. Tubular glands exhibit subnuclear vacuolation. Mid-secretory, the glands contain supranuclear vacuoles with secretions within the glandular lumina. There's marked stromal edema in the last photomicrograph. Then the late secretory phase of breakdown with glandular changes like glandular crowding, nuclear debris, papillary syncytial metaplasia, the stromal changes like stromal collapse, aggregates of stromal cells, nuclear debris, fibrin thrombi, hemosiderin pigment deposition, foam cell accumulation, fibrosis, and hyalinization. As you can see here is a spiral arteriole. The breaking down endometrium, the stromal cells aggregate into stromal loop walls. With breakdown, fibrin thrombi are seen in the second photomicrograph. With breakdown, the endometrial glands become disrupted and crowded because of the stromal collapse. Then the lower uterine segment endometrium, it is composed of inactive, poorly developed glands and sometimes you can receive them in the endometrial biopsy. Lower uterine segment endometrium may be mistaken for a polyp in a biopsy specimen. When area stellar reaction, gestational changes, gestural changes, there is nuclear enlargement, hyperchromasia, abundant eosinophilic vacuous cytoplasm, hobnail appearance with cells protruding into glandular lumen. Then postmenopausal or atrophy, common in postmenopausal women due to estrogen withdrawal, glands composed of inactive low columnar tetravagal cells, glands often detached from stroma forming hairpin structures may have cystic changes. Then there may be estrogen-related dysfunctional uterine bleeding, including endometrium associated with an ovulatory cycle, which can give a picture of a disordered proliferative endometrium, which would have occasionally cystically dilated glands within an otherwise typical proliferative endometrium. It can be called as an ovulatory or persistent proliferative endometrium. Then there can be progesterone-related dysfunctional uterine bleeding or a luteal phase defect. Then effects of exogenous hormones and HRT, hormone replacement therapy, which can give a decidualized appearance, such as recognized in the histomorphology. Then various metaplasias can be seen, squamous metaplasia or the squamous modules, and then the mucinous and ciliated metaplasia. There's a clear cell metaplasia in endometrium, eosinophilic metaplasia, papillary proliferation. These are all benign changes, the hobnail cell metaplasia. So basically, when you see a polypoidal lesion in the endometrium, the differential diagnosis most commonly benign endometrial polyp, atypical polypoid adenomyoma, or a adenosarcoma, which is a malignancy. So endometrial polyp is a polypoid piece of tissue lined by epithelium on three sides, glands set in a stroma that is qualitatively different from the endometrial stroma in the non-polypoid fragments, glandular architectural abnormality with dilated glands and sometimes mild glandular crowding, collection of thick walled stromal blood vessels. Then atypical polypoidal adenomyoma. The biphasic polypoidal lesion composed of endometrioid-type glands in the myxomatous or a fibromyomatous stroma. So also called as atypical polypoid adenomyofibroma. Most patients are perimenopausal. In some cases, the diagnosis is made during investigations for infertility. There is MLH1 promoter hypermethylation molecular alterations in this. This is the photomicrograph, atypical polypoid adenomyoma, proliferation of endometrial glands embedded in a background of intersecting myometrial vesicles, no cytological ageria. So, the differential diagnosis of endometrial polyp, benign endometrial polyp, polypoid adenomyoma, then complex atypical hyperplasia or a epithelial, intraepithelial neoplasm. This is a endometrial intraepithelial neoplasm in a polyp, atypical polypoid adenomyoma, adenosarcoma, carcinoma, and a carcinosarcoma. So obviously the carcinoma, carcinosarcoma, they are malignant. The stroma in a carcinoma is benign, but in carcinosarcoma it is malignant, and the management is based upon as per the diagnosis of it. So endometrial sampling, ideally for infertility, the biopsy is taken the mid-secretory phase in 7th and 11th post-ovulatory day. Endometrial polypectomy may be undertaken. So, in those instances, sampling of the non-polypoid endometrium should also be undertaken. Then, transcervical resection of the endometrium for menorrhagia or multiple polyps or an endometrial hyperplasia or a low-grade endometrioid adenocarcinoma. All endometrial specimens should be submitted in their entirety for histological examination, exceptions being large endometrial polyps. Then, adequate clinical history is also very important, and the LMP is must. you may get various artifacts and contaminants, but sometimes you can get a very scanty endometrial biopsy. The triple biopsy in postmenopausal women, the specimen consists entirely of superficial strips of atrophic endometrial glands. Then they get telescopic glands, within glands, glandular molding, vacuolation of endometrial stromal cells, pseudopapillary endometrium. These are all artifacts. Then the condition is endometritis. So as I have said, there can be hematopoietic cells, like stromal granulocytes in the endometrium. It is a histological diagnosis, this abnormal pattern of inflammatory infiltrate. Most cases occur in the reproductive years, but sometimes postmenopausal women are affected. It can be acute and chronic. Diagnosis before a recent pregnancy, presence of an intrauterine device, cervical stenosis, prior instrumentation. It can be focal or diffuse. There can be spindle cell alteration of the stroma. Sometimes you have to resort to IHC with CD138 to highlight the plasma cells and CD20 to see the lymphoid cells. And this is actinomycotic granules with a basophilic radiating filament, pseudoactinomycotic radiate granules, and granulomatous endometritis. Then there can be Marina coil associated endometrium. There's a polypoid architecture. There is the decidualization. There is hemosiderin pigment. Then there can be sarcoma bodies in the endometrium. Then stromal cells may look atypical. The radiation effect, the glands are lined by cells with enlarged atypical nuclei. Placental site nodule, as we see in the lower photomicrograph, and intravascular menstrual endometrium, the last photomicrograph. Adenomyosis, another condition, non-neoplastic lesion of myometrial tissue, presence of endometrial glands and stroma within myometrium. Synonyms are myometrial endometriosis, superficial adenomyosis, stromal adenomyosis. Usually an incidental finding in hysterectomy specimen may be diffuse or focal, may be involved by hyperplasia and carcinoma. Adenomyoma is a circumscribed nodular aggregate of benign endometrial glands surrounded by endometrial stroma with leiomyomatous smooth muscle bordering the endometrial stromal component. That's the difference. Pathophysiology, chronic uterine autotraumatization by physiological mechanical functions, tissue injury and repair. Prolactin and immune factors may play a role. Adenomyosis and endometriosis are usually regarded as closely related, but microscopic appearance and probably their pathogenesis are somewhat different. They may occur independently of each other. Adenomyosis is made up of non-functional endometrium, basal, and is frequently connected with the mucosa. Endometriosis is composed of the functional layer. Then there are various hypotheses of how it develops installation of endometrium within the myometrium. Then there is some genetic chromosomal deletions of 7q21 2q31.2. These are found in cases of adenomyosis. This can also cause dysmenorrhea. It tends to regress after menopause. Then there is endometrial hyperplasia diagnostic scheme, WHO 2014. Endometrial hyperplasia without ATPR due to unopposed estrogen with disordered proliferation. Endometrioid intraepithelial neoplasia, atypical endometrial hyperplasia, and carcinoma. So this is a progression due to the estrogen unopposed effect. Endometrial hyperplasia without ATPR. Exaggerated proliferation of glands of irregular size and shape with an associated increase in the gland to stroma ratio compared with proliferative endometrium, but without significant cytological ATPR. also called as benign endometrial hyperplasia, simple non-atypical endometrial hyperplasia. Risk factors are obesity, polycystic ovarian syndrome, diabetes. Clinical features, it results from prolonged estrogen exposure unopposed by progesterone or progestational agents. It is most commonly diagnosed in perimenopausal with symptoms of abnormal non-cyclical vaginal bleeding. It may become polypoid lesion. The spectrum of changes is typical. Glands vary in size. Glands are irregularly distributed with variable density of glands to stroma. Some glands may have normal coil structure, others branch or acoustically dilated. The epithelium is of stratified columnar type with frequent mitotic figures. Focal hemorrhage and stromal breakdown are common. An atypical hyperplasia or a endometrioid intraepithelial neoplasia. Cytological atypia superimposed on endometrial hyperplasia defines atypical hyperplasia. Patient is usually old, 53 years or more. Endogenous or exogenous hyperhistrionism is a risk factor. Postmenopausal bleeding or abnormal vaginal bleeding is most common presenting symptom. Endometrium may be diffusely thickened. It's composed of crowded aggregates of cytologically altered tubular or branching glands. Within the geographic confines of the lesion, the area of glands exceeds that of the stroma. Histogenesis, as I already told, continuous unopposed estrogenic stimulation leads to progression of hyperplasia without atypia to EIN and atypical hyperplasia. Genetic profile, microsatellite instability, PASTO inactivation, PTN, KRAS, and CTNNB1 catenin mutation. Cowden syndrome and Lynch syndrome may be associated. So, this is simple hyperplasia versus a complex atypical hyperplasia. Although complex hyperplasia and EIN are often overlapping diagnoses, they're slightly different diagnostic criteria. EIN is likely more specific, while complex hyperplasia is more sensitive. Both are acceptable by WHO. Diagnostic criteria of EIN, crowded glands, the gland to stroma ratio more than 1:1, altered cytology, and must be more than 1 millimeter within a single tissue fragment. Then comes to the neoplastic lesion. I will not be dealing with presently with the leiomyomas and leiomyosarcoma because there are lots of changes in the endometrioid carcinoma as per the new WHO classification. So that has to be dealt with in detail. This is the TNM and TIGO classification of carcinomas of the uterine endometrium. So the endometrial tumors, which will be covered, it includes the spectrum of endometrial glandular neoplasia, endometrioid intraepithelial neoplasia, a precursor to endometrioid type 1 endometrial adenocarcinoma, precursor to serous carcinoma, endometrial adenocarcinoma, then endometrial thyroid adenocarcinoma, serous clear cell carcinoma, tumors with mixed epithelial and stromal differentiation, endometrial stromal tumors, and non-Mullerian neoplasms. So this is the latest what I could get from the Fletcher 5th edition. Endometrial adenocarcinoma endometrioid type 1, which is grade 1 to 3, and it may present with secretory differentiation, squamous differentiation, mucinous differentiation. An endometrial adenocarcinoma non-endometrioid type 2, it is grade 3 by definition. They are serous, clear cell, carcinosarcoma, endometrial adenocarcinoma miscellaneous, and rare transitional type. So approach to the difficult endometrial lesion based upon the architectural pattern, the high risk pattern, then there is a borderline, and there's a low risk pattern, which is the hyperplasia. The risk factors for endometrial carcinomas: tamoxifen, unopposed estrogen therapy, early menarche, late menopause, obesity, diabetes, polycystic ovary syndrome, ovarian sex cord stromal tumors. And as I have told, hereditary non-polyposis colorectal carcinoma syndrome or Lynch syndrome, cigarette smoking is supposed to reduce the risk of endometrial carcinoma. Tamoxifen. Women treated with tamoxifen are particularly prone to develop endometrial polyps, but there is also a risk factor in endometrial adenocarcinoma. This is a simplified view, type 1 and type 2. Type 2, it's by grade 3 and non-endometrioid type, around 10%. Common is endometrioid, 80 to 90%. This is the architectural grading. Grade 1, no more than 5% of the tumor is composed of solid mass. Grade 2, 6 to 50% of the tumor is composed of solid mass. Grade 3, more than 50% of the tumor is composed of solid mass. This is the TIGO grading of grade 1, grade 2, and grade 3. High grade nuclear atypia in this tumor with no solid growth, grade 1 architecture. Increase the grade by 1 unit to grade 2 because there is a high grade nuclear atypia. So type 1 and type 2, as we see here, type 1 in the background of hyperplasia, type 2 background is atrophic, obesity, hyperlipidemia, diabetes, type 1, tumor grade is low in type 1, prognosis is favorable, type 2, like the serous, there are unfavorable prognosis. Then P53, 90%, it is mutated in type 2, genetic alteration, PKN mutation, KRAS, PIK3CA, CTNNB1, ARIGIA, HER2 new amplification, and microsatellite instability. So this is the pathogenesis and the molecular alterations which can occur at every level from benign to malignant, how they develop, the grade 3 endometrioid, unopposed estrogen, non-atypical hyperplasia, then complex atypical hyperplasia, low-grade endometrioid, then TP53 and HER2 mutation, grade 3 endometrioid. And here we see the uterine serous carcinoma pathway, the serous endometrial intraepithelial carcinoma with TP53, PICK, and lots of molecular markers are implicated and progression to uterine serous carcinoma. This is a novel molecular classification of endometrial carcinoma, the cancer genome atlas classification, somatic copy number alterations, and tumor mutation burden. Four distinct classes are fold mutant, endometrial carcinoma, microsatellite instability associated, then endometrial carcinoma with PI3K, AKT, and WNT signaling pathways, and endometrial carcinoma with T53 mutation with high somatic copy number alteration. Fold mutant, early stage, usually an excellent prognosis. It's a grade 3 endometrioid carcinoma with ambiguous morphology. It may have tumor giant cells and prominent tumor infiltrating lymphocytes. MSI associated, grade 3 endometrioid with tumor infiltrating lymphocytes and peritumoral lymphocytes, more common in low uterine segment. Non-endometrioid subtypes can also occur. A so-called microcystic elongated and fragmented MELF pattern of invasion and lymphovascular invasion have also been associated. Somatic copy number alteration is low, it is having an intermediate prognosis. Then endometrial carcinoma with PICK, AKT and WNT signaling pathway, grade 1 to 2 with ER and PR positivity. Most common gene mutated is PTN and CTNNB. It is having a variable prognosis. And this is T53 aberrant mutant endometrial carcinoma, high-grade endometrioid endometrial carcinomas and serous carcinoma, destructive invasion and frequent lymphovascular invasion. This is having a poor prognosis. So, this is the dualistic Bachman classification. This is summarizing the total classification in one nutshell, the type 1, type 2, the risk factor, the molecular factors, and the various TCGA molecular classifications. This is the algorithm for the pole sequencing. When the pole sequencing is present, it is an endometrial carcinoma pole. If it is absent, the expression is loss of DNA NMR protein, then it becomes MSI-H high. Then P53, if copy number is low and copy number is high, then it is a bad prognosis, serous carcinoma. So this is the algorithm for molecular classification. It has got therapeutic implications for different molecular subtypes because MMR referred for hereditary carrier cancer counseling and testing options in immunotherapy, pole options in immunotherapy, P53, lower likelihood metastatic disease, and P53 is abnormal. P53, if it is not mutated, there is lower likelihood. If it is abnormal, fertility sparing treatment is not recommended. Complete aggressive surgical staging is done. This is the IHC which is done in common types of endometrial carcinoma. So as we see here in endometrioid, P53, it is positive in grade 3. Then P16 is patchy, ER is positive, PR positive, that is negative in clear cell and may be negative in serous. And NAPSIN, HNF1 beta and P53 is wild type in low grade endometrioid, mutated in high grade, serous it is abnormal and clear cell it is wild type. And this is the IHC to differentiate the endocervical adenocarcinoma usual and endometrioid type and endometrial adenocarcinoma endometrioid type. As we have seen in the earlier lecture, P16 is positive in endocervical adenocarcinoma and it may be negative in endometrioid or a patchy. And ER-PR by Lentin will be negative in endocervical and positive in the endometrial adenocarcinoma. Coming to the grossing, you have to take ink the serosa, then take the complete section, full thickness endomyometrium and serosa to assess the depth of invasion, one section per centimeter of tumor, minimum 3 sections, and this is the core data elements, specimen integrity, tumor size, histologic type, histologic grade, myometrial invasion, tumor involvement of cervix, peritoneal wash, ascitic fluid, lymphovascular invasion, regional lymph nodes, distant mets, additional findings like hyperplasia or EIN, and biomarkers like ER, PR, MMR protein, IHC, P53. So this is the complete description of the gross and the histology, how it should be reported for a specimen of hysterectomy with endometrial carcinoma. Myometrial invasion, depth of invasion should be measured from the endomyometrial junction to the deepest point of invasion. Carcinoma involving adenomyotic foci should not be interpreted as invasive carcinoma. This is the measurement of depth of invasion. A is the tumor with a regular interface. B is a tumor with an irregular endomyometrial interface. C and D, tumor with an exophytic growth. A tumor arising from adenomyosis in E. Typical MELF type of in myo-invasive trans microcystic elongated and fragmented tumor cells associated with extensive fibromyxoid reaction. So it's very difficult to measure the depth of invasion here. So very carefully it is done as per the protocol. This is the AGCC-TNM and FIGO staging of endometrial carcinoma. Very important and one can't memorize everything, but then you have to always keep it handy. So endometrioid carcinoma, you summarize and you see the various growth patterns like cribriform, below glandular, molecules. Then, as I said, all the classifications, like the molecular classifications and the algorithms, myo-invasion we have discussed, challenging patterns are Cushing invasion, microcystic like elongated and fragmented MELF, and diffusely infiltrative MELTER pattern. Then, lymphovascular invasion, frequently seen with MELF pattern. Sometimes, intravascular cells can appear histiocytoid, requiring stains to confirm that they are tumors. Then other endometrial carcinomas like serous carcinoma, clear cell carcinoma with hobnailing, mucinous carcinoma, and mixed type of carcinoma. When there are two more distinctive subtypes of endometrial carcinoma, each representing at least 5% of the tumor. Mucinous carcinoma is when more than 50% of the neoplasm is mucinous. Otherwise, it should be told with mucinous differentiation. The photomicrograph showing the serous carcinoma and the mucinous carcinoma, secondary type PIGO grade 1, then the below glandular morphology. Then there is endometrioid carcinoma with squamous differentiation and focal squamous differentiation, PIGO grade 3 in the last photomicrograph. This is a serous carcinoma, the papillary architecture. Then you resort to IHC with P53, diffuse strong nuclear expression of P53 and T16. This clear cell carcinoma, hobnailing. The hobnail type cells protrude prominently into the gland lumen and are pleomorphic with hyperchromatic nuclei. Hyalinized papillae can be found, lined by cells with clear to eosinophilic cytoplasm and pleomorphic nuclei. Then other spectrum after that could be adenofibroma, dense fibrous connective tissue with interspersed glandular spaces and periglandular condensation of stromal cells, no marked cellularity, nuclear atypia and mitosis, less than 2/10 high power field. Adenosarcoma, pilosite architecture, periglandular stromal condensation with nuclear atypia and mitosis, more than 2/10 high power field in stromal cells, epithelium is benign. IHC is 3/10, CR, and SMA is variable. Then carcinosarcoma, glandular architecture may have an endometrioid, clear cell, serous, mucinous, yolk sac, or mesonephric differentiation. Mesenchymal component could be homologous and heterologous edema. They show concordant staining for P53, supporting their common clonal origin. Then they could be undifferentiated carcinomas with no differentiation and de-differentiated endometrial carcinoma. Few questions like the staging of uterine carcinoma, divide stage 3, T3, 3 disease depending upon the number of abdominal sites involved by the tumor. Then defining feature of stage 3A is involvement of uterine serosa or adnexa. Then serous carcinoma, mutations in P53 are the most common driving molecular event. Then there is myometrial mass. We leave this. Women with a myometrial mass with lung metastasis, myometrial tumor, decessive epitheloid and spindle cells, HMB-45, Desmin, SMA and Cal-Desmond positive, that's the PCOMA. Then molecular alterations in uterine leiomyosarcomas, it is PP53. And uterine mass in a 50-year-old woman with CD10 and CD117 negativity with SMA, ERPR and H. Cal-Desmond positive, it's a leiomyosarcoma. Then inflammatory myofibroblastic tumor with a ALK rearrangement. uterine inflammatory myofibroblastic tumor. ALK rearrangement is seen in this. And this is a hysterectomy, 27-year-old, gender dysphoria, cervical section, occasional presence of umbrella transitional cell metaplasia. Then well-differentiated endometrial endometroid adenocarcinoma, PAX8, PK7, positivity, wild type P53, and patchy focal T16. Which chromosomal abnormality is associated with the histological findings from endometrial biopsy of a 35-year-old woman with abnormal uterine bleeding, it is 6p21 aberration. These are the references. Thank you.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Excellent as usual. Wonderful presentation. So crisp and to the point. And I think the postgraduate students will really love the way you teach, because you are exactly giving them what they actually require and they want. Wonderful.
Yeah,
presentation.
One thing I missed was the leiomyosarcomas and all, but then that was like I could not find any changes in the new WHO and all, so I have intentionally skipped that actually.
No problem.
Yes.
Most important was the molecular classification of endometrial carcinoma, which is very important. I think everybody should lay stress on that. Thank you so much. I would love to have the PDF so that I can share with the rest of the people also.
Yes.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Take care. Thank you so much. God bless you. Good night. Bye. Bye-bye.